yesterday evening. We were teaching on the New Testament commandments. And then right after, while I was teaching, there was a preacher that looked in on me and was watching me. And of course, his broadcast was right after mine. And then when I left, because usually the broadcast ends at 7 o'clock, 7:01, 7:02, I'm in my car heading out. And then he got on there. There ain't no New Testament commandments. And all these type of things. And just trying to blast us, you know. But we don't get on there and try to attack anybody. And you know, we just get on there and teach the word. Now, he's on 7 days a week. And some of those days, he's on twice a day. I said, now, if he's got a church, he must not be doing nothing much with it, because I ain't got time to be on the radio every 7 days a week, two times a day. Praise the Lord. But he's on there trying to speak against everything that we're teaching. Praise the Lord. And the thing about it, though, is that he's on there saying those things, but he ain't giving no scripture to back up what he's saying. And because when I was trained by the late Bishop Paddock on how to teach the scriptures, and also by my pastor, Bishop Combs, and you're supposed to teach in a manner of which it is, how can we put it, that you teach in a manner to where it is irrefutable, and that if anybody is going to try to refute it, you use so much scripture that they can't refute it. All they can do is just cite their opinion. And so that's how the fathers taught, and that's how I was taught to teach. That's why we use so many volumes of scripture, because the Bible is written in subjects, and in each of the subjects, various subjects may have hundreds and hundreds, and in some cases, may even thousands of scriptures. I remember one time I was studying the heart of man, and there was something like 850 scriptures that dealt with the heart. And then once I went through all those verses, then I ran across the mind. So you had to go through hundreds of scriptures that deal with the mind, and so on and so forth. And that's how we were taught to study the Bible, so that then when you're teaching a subject, you have so much volume of scripture, and that anyone that tries to refute it or say that it's not true, they pretty much will have to find some other scripture that you didn't use. And how can they do that when we covered all of them in our studies? Now, we may not give you all of them in Bible class, but for the most part, we do have quite a few of them. I taught on the Godhead, series on the Godhead 1 year, and we covered almost 900 verses of scripture that dealt with the Godhead. And then people like to try to use Matthew 28:19 to try to say there's a Trinity. Now, I remember Bishop Paddock taught on the Godhead, and he said he used 1,100 scriptures. Now, I didn't have as many as he had, but I had 900. And so he used to make the point, and I made the same point also. Now, which scriptures you going to go with? The 900 that show that Jesus is God, or the one, Matthew 28:19, that make it seem like that there's three? And of course, we even use that one also. So it's really something how people say they don't believe what you're teaching, but they can't prove that what you're teaching is wrong. That says a whole lot. Can we say amen? Amen. Because the truth is something that cannot be destroyed. One writer said, "Truth crushed to the earth shall rise again." And of course, Jesus was the truth, and they tried to crush him, but he rose from the dead. Is that right? Praise the Lord. He rose from the dead. So, but, you know, you're going to have these things. We are in the era of false doctrine. We're in the era of deception. At one time, the church was in the era of persecution. But nowadays, they pretty much embrace anyone that goes to church for the most part, so we're not really suffering persecution in this country as it was in the years past, but what we have to deal with today is deception. And deception can be so close to the truth to where you almost cannot tell the difference. You have to really be well taught and believe and live what you have been taught in order to fight the false teachings and the errors that are going on today. And so that's very important. So that's why we have two Bible classes during the week, because the instruction that we get from God's word, as we get closer and closer to the coming of Christ, the spirit of deception is going to be stronger and stronger. And even as Jesus said in Matthew 24, that there's going to come a time where deception is going to be so powerful that if it were possible, it would deceive the very elect. Now, that is a very powerful statement that he made, because the elect in the scriptures are those that God has seen make the rapture in the end. The elect are those that God has seen make it. And Jesus said deception will be so powerful that if it were possible, the very elect could be deceived. But they cannot be deceived. But that just gives you some sort of a frame of reference as just how powerful deception will be and how powerful deception is today. Anyone that has been deceived, they all believe that they're right. They all believe that they're right. And that's what we're dealing with today. So we're dealing with corruption tonight, but we're going to deal with the spirit of error first of all. And so let's go to First Epistle of John, chapter number 4, and deal with verse 1 through 6, and we're going to get out right at 9 o'clock, so that gives us about an hour to teach, since this is a Friday night. And as I said, if people knew or believed that Jesus was going to come between 7 and 8 o'clock, they probably would have been here at 5:30. They really believe. But of course, we know we have some out of town, some are working, and some are probably just getting back from out of town, and some of them may be staying at home watching their favorite program, and then the Lord fixed them to where the cable went out, and they sit up and say, I should have went to church. Praise the Lord. All right, but we hope that's not the case, but God has ways. Is that right? He has ways. All right. We're going to read 1 John chapter 4. Verse number 1, and we're going to deal with verse 1 through 6, but let's read verse number 1. All right, we have it. Let's read. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Now, anytime you see the word beloved, who is he referencing to? Who is he talking to? The church. The church of God, the beloved of God, the beloved. And of course, this is John. He's writing this epistle while he was in prison on the Isle of Patmos. The Lord appeared to him in a vision on that island and told him to write. And that's when he wrote the gospel according to St. John, the first, second, third epistle of John, and the book of Revelation. We have to teach on that sometime. But when Jesus appeared to him, he told him, write the things which thou hast seen, which would be the gospel of St. John, the things which are, which would be the epistles, because the epistles that he wrote, the first epistle of John, second and third, dealt with the church age of which he was in, and the things which shall be hereafter. And that has to do with the fourth chapter and on when it comes to the book of Revelation. So the things, he says, write the things that which thou hast seen, which was the gospel according to St. John, things which are, which is 1 John, 2nd, 3rd, and the first three chapters of the book of Revelation, and the things which shall be hereafter, which is from chapter 4. So he is writing this epistle, and he's writing to the saints. He says, beloved, believe not what? Every spirit. Now, the Bible says there's one spirit. Is that right? Can we say amen? There's one spirit. There is one spirit of God. But angels are spirits. The Bible says they're ministering spirits. And then demons are angels, but they are fallen angels. Now, of course, we don't know exactly how many of them there are. There are probably billions of them. However, he tells us to believe not every spirit. Now, in this text, when he talks about a spirit, he is talking about a persuasion, a spirit that comes with a certain kind of mindset or thought or teaching that is motivated by a spirit other than the Spirit of God. There are things that are motivated in this world other than by the Spirit of God. God inspires things, and the devil inspires things. There are teachings of man, there's teachings of God, and there's teachings of the devil. And this is where we get the three kinds of doctrines that are spoken of in the scriptures. There's the doctrine of men, I think it's spoken of in Matthew chapter 19, I believe it is. The doctrines of men, that is teachings that have been inspired by man. Then in 1 Timothy chapter 4, he talks about doctrines of devils, that is teachings that have been inspired by devils. Then in Hebrews chapter 6, you have the doctrine of Christ, that is teachings that have been inspired by who? Jesus Christ. So you have the spirit of man that inspires teachings. You have the spirit of the devil that inspires teachings. Then you have the Spirit of God, which is the Holy Ghost, that inspires and gives revelation of his teachings. And these are the spirits that we have to deal with, the spirit of man and the spirit of the devil. And when it comes to these spirits, because we all have the spirit of mankind, because we're human beings, there are times where our spirit can generate thoughts in our minds, belief systems in our minds that will cause us to believe certain things based upon what we received out of our thoughts. So there are the spirit of man that comes out with teachings. There's the spirit of the devil, teachings that have been inspired by the powers of darkness that tries to come upon a person or individual, get a person to believe those certain things. And so, whether it is our own human spirit, or whether it is the spirit of the devil, and in this text, he talks about the spirit of the Antichrist, all right? Any spirit or any persuasion, any teaching, any thought, any motivation, any inspiration that is Antichrist, or any spirit. He says, believe not every what? Spirit. You can't believe every spirit. Believe not every spirit. But what did he say do? But try the spirits, and try them as to what? Whether they are of God. Now, how do I try the spirit? How do I determine whether or not a spirit or a teaching, or an influence, or a behavior, or a thought is from God? Well, how did Jesus deal when the spirit came to him? The devil came to him and tried to convince him to do certain things. He tried that spirit. What did he use? The word of God. And so Jesus said, I think it's in St. John chapter 6, I believe it is, that the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So you try those spirits by this spirit, which is the word of God. And if it doesn't line up with what the spirit of God says, then it is not of God. Now, Even if it sounds good, just because it sounds good doesn't mean that it is of what? It is of God. Just because it's believable by many people doesn't mean that it is of who? Of God. Doesn't mean that it is of God. And see, people think that everything that is good comes from God. That's not true. Everything that is good does not come from God. Satan can generate that which is good because he is a master deceiver. It's Satan's job to convince us that certain things are from God when they are not, because that's the only way he can deceive us. If he can trick us into thinking something that is not, like he did Eve, in order for him to deceive Eve, he had to make her believe that this is what God wants you to do. You know, and that's how he works. So we have to try the Spirit. And that's why the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, let the prophet speak two or three and let the other judge. Whenever a preacher is up preaching or teaching, we are supposed to sit back and judge whether he is speaking by the Spirit of God or by his own spirit or by some demon spirit. That's what the Bible says. Can we say amen? That's 1 Corinthians chapter 14. You know, because he says, believe not what? Every spirit. Now, when the Apostle Paul was teaching in one of the cities, he was teaching Thessalonians in Thessalonica, and he was impressed with how readily they received the word. Then he went to Berea and taught the word of God there. But there was something about the people in Berea that were different than Thessalonica, because the scripture says that those that were in Berea were more noble than those in Thessalonica, because they took what Paul taught them and went home and searched it out to see if it was right. And that's what we're supposed to do. If it don't line up with the word, it's not right. And so we have to try the Spirit. So in order to do that, we have to know the word of God. Is that right? People that are deceived, they have one trait. People that are deceived have one trait about them that is common, and that is they're not really astute in truth as they ought to be. They either are not as astute in it, or they don't really love it, or they haven't really received it fully. Because once you get the truth, truth is the remedy that, and it is the only thing that can combat error and falsehood. Let me say amen. All right, now, he says, and we have a little feedback here, so to bear with us a little bit here with the system. Believe not every spirit, try the spirit, whether they are of God. Why? Let's read. Because many false prophets are going out into the what? To the world. And you cannot necessarily tell a false prophet by just the naked eye. As we said, taught on Wednesday night, you shall know them how? By their fruits, how they live. Generally, if they don't preach against sin, something's wrong somewhere. So, let's pick it up. Verse number 2. Hereby know ye, Spirit of God. In other words, hereby means by this, or here is by you know the Spirit of God, or that this is from God. Let's read. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is a what? Now notice he said every spirit. Every spirit. That every spirit has to do with someone that is preaching or confessing as to who Jesus is. See, don't think of it as some ghost that's coming in saying, no, these, he's dealing with spirits that are in people that get up to teach and preach. All right? This is how we know the Spirit of God. This is how we know that this is from God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. In other words, anyone that teaches that Jesus was God in human flesh is of who? Is of God. apostolics, we are the only ones that believe in one God. There is no other religion on earth that believes in one God. Now, Islam talk about that they believe in one God, but when you really get into the study of Islam, you will find that they really are polytheistic or believe in more than one God, just like anybody else. They pretty much teach that every Islamic man is his own God, and that Allah is just the supreme God. And of course, they worship the crescent moon and all these type of things. So they like to say that they believe in one God, but really they don't. If you really look at their teachings, the problem is that many people don't take out the time to study their teachings and read their books, but they are not one God. The Apostolic Church is the only people that is monotheistic or believe in one what? One God. Now, you have the Trinitarians will tell you that Jesus is God. And of course, I had one bishop try to convince us to say that the Trinitarians believe the same thing that we believe as far as one God. I said, now I know better than that. Because I know the doctrine of the Trinity. That it has varied down through the years, but it's still the same. You know, the Trinitarians will tell you that Jesus is God. But if you ask them, is he the Father? That's where the difference is. Because they say he is God. He's the second God of the Trinity. They tell you that the Holy Spirit is God. Now, Fred Hammond has a song to where he is singing to the Father, the Spirit, and the Son. Now, Fred Hammond has been baptized in Jesus' name from the Holy Ghost. But he is singing that song. Now, somebody may say, well, he's saved. He doesn't really believe in the Trinity. But then as I was listening to the song, and then the moderator came on the radio, he said, that's why I love Fred Hammond. He recognizes the Trinity. Now, I'm not trying to cast any aspersion on Fred Hammond. I have a lot of his songs. I think he's an excellent singer. But I'm just making the point. You know, when you ask them, do you believe that Jesus is the Father? And that's the difference between us and them. So everyone that says that Jesus is the Father, or that Jesus came in human flesh, or that Jesus was God manifest flesh, and they wouldn't even say that. Because their teaching is that, well, Jesus manifest himself in flesh. In other words, the Son of God came down from heaven and took on flesh. We don't believe the Son of God came down from heaven. God himself came down and inhabited human flesh, and that the flesh is the Son of God, his humanity, but the person in that body was the Father himself. So there's a big difference between us. And of course, the reason why I'm making these points is because there are many of our brethren that are trying to say we are the same as the Kojic, that we are the same as the Assemblies of God, and we are not the same. And the reason why they like to say that we're the same is because they see the big crowds that they have and they want the big crowds. Well, God has never been into the crowd. He's never been into the crowd. You know, God is not into numbers. It's always been a very few, a remnant of his people that have been successful with him. But that's what we're dealing with today. We're dealing with ecumenicalism. All the religious need to get together. You are separated. God is not in separation. Yes, he is in separation. That's where you get the word sanctification from. Sanctification means to be separate, set apart for the use of God. Can we say amen? I mean, that's what Jesus said on one occasion. I came not to bring peace on the earth, but a sword. You ever figured out what he was talking about? He said, to divide the father from his son, and the mother from her daughter, and the brothers from the sisters. Yea, a man's foe will be they of his household. That sword he talked about that brings division is salvation, is what it does. See, He brings us out of the kingdom of darkness and puts us in the kingdom of his dear what? Son. And that separates us. That's the sword. What is that sword? It's the word of God that brings salvation. The sword of the Spirit, which is what? Word of God. You ever read that? I know you read it. Sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So when he said, I came not to bring peace on the earth, but a sword. And that sword is the word of God that we are saved by through the plan of salvation that separates us from everybody else. Because what God does is that when he saves us, he brings us unto himself. Whereas before we were without hope and without God in this world. And so that is what he is in. That is sanctification. And so the spirit of error says we all need to be together. The spirit of error says we all need to worship together. We are all serving the same God. It doesn't matter what you call him, it's the same God. Thou shalt call his name what? It doesn't matter what you call him. Because if you face to face with a demon and talking about Allah, that demon's going to stomp on your foot and slap you up. You know? So, because people say, well, it don't matter what you call him. Oh, yes, it does. It don't matter what you call him, because the Bible says the name of the Lord is a what? It does matter what you call him. Somebody says if you call on Jesus, he will what? You call on Allah, you ain't going to get nothing. You call on Buddha, you're just going to get tired of doing all that chanting and hungry, and then afterwards you're just going to go on about your business. But it does matter. So, as late Bishop Carl F. Smith said, that view of inclusiveness, all of us to get together, all religions get together, is not going to work. Can you imagine Moses getting together with the Amalekites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Canaanites? One of the worst civilizations that ever lived, the Canaanites. No, God didn't send him to do that. And Israel was a type of the church. So that's not what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be here preaching the gospel, living the life so that souls can be saved and getting ready to meet Jesus. Can we say amen? Amen. All right. So he says, that's how we know the Spirit of God. And how is it that we know the Spirit of God? If they say that Jesus Christ came in the flesh, why? Because that's what the word says. The word says he came. God was manifest in flesh. We know that's true because of what the word says. Well, let's read on. Verse 3, and every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is what? Anyone that teaches that Jesus is not God in human flesh, anyone that teaches that the Father did not come down and take on human flesh, that's not of who? God. You know why it's not of God? Because that spirit does not line up with this spirit. That's why. Well, what kind of spirit is it? And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. What kind of spirit is it? Let's read. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is it where? Bishop Haywood said in his book that any church or any teaching that does not believe that Jesus is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost has the spirit of Antichrist. Because to teach that God is other than what he said he is in his word is anti-Christ. It's not pro-Christ, it's what? Anti-Christ. Now, that don't mean that they can't repent and be saved. He didn't say that, you know, because all of us at some point were lost sinners and God saved us. But how he brought us is that he dealt with our hearts and we repented. We gave up our will, our thoughts, our teachings. I mean, you know, it seems like that the Baptist faith is the religion of every black person that's ever lived to some degree. But in order for God to save us, we had to turn our back on what we were raised in. Is that right? So if a person has a spirit of Antichrist, they can be saved too if they do the same thing that we did. Repent, go down in Jesus' name, fill with the Holy Ghost, and be taught and to receive. But the problem we have today is that many people can't seem to unlearn what they learn out in the world. They still want to hold on to some of those things. And you can't do that. So, the spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is it where? Now, this was 2,000 years ago. It was already then. And you know it's here now. Any spirit or anyone or any teaching or any thought or any influence or any inspiration that is not according to this is not of God. And in order for us to determine whether it is of God, we have to know what this says and see if it lines up with it. And if it don't line up with it, then we know it's not of who? Not of God. All right? Let's read. Verse 4. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them. Who have we overcome? False prophets, spirit of Antichrist, all those things. Let's read. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is where? Who's in the world? The devil. Because of who is in us. He that is within us is greater than he that is in the world. Let's read on. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world does what? Heareth them. All right. Let's look at the flip side. Verse 6. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth what? Not us. Hereby, or by here, know we the spirit of truth and the what? So if I cannot hear the pastor, but I'm saying when the pastor's teaching truth, and I can't hear him, but I can hear the world, then I have the spirit of what? Error. The spirit of error. And the spirit of error is simply a deviation from what is true. It has to do with a wandering away from the right way. And that's what the enemy tries to do. It gets us off into error, deviate from the truth, from what we have been taught. So there is a way to discern from the spirit of truth and the spirit of error, and you do it by the word of God as you have been taught. That's how we're able to discern. And see, a lot of people today, it's very unfortunate because people don't really recognize the anointing as they should, because people think the anointing is in the theatrics of the preacher. They think that the anointing is in the shouting of the people. But if a person is up preaching in error and people are shouting off his error, then is that God? No, that's the spirit of what? And it happens a lot. It happens all the time. We have got to be able to discern between what God is in and what God is not in. As I think it was James said, the Hebrew writer said, having our senses exercised to discern both good and evil, to be able to tell what is good or what is evil, to be able to discern what is of God and what is not of God. Because a lot of the things that are out there are not of God, but people are saying they are of God, because many people have the spirit of error. Well, let's read on here. He says, this is how we know the spirit of error. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. So in other words, if we are of God and we are speaking the things of God and people don't want to hear us, They don't want to hear God. They have the spirit of what? Error. The spirit of error. All right? So, let us now go to James chapter 5, verse 19 through 20. James chapter 5. Well, let me see here. Could deal with verse 13 all the way down, but all right. James chapter 5. And let's pick it up. Verse number 19 and 20 is what we're interested in. James 5, verse 19 through 20. All right. If we have, let's read. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth and one what? That word err means to wander away from the truth. Means to deviate or to miss the mark. If any of you do err from the truth and one convert him. Now, in other words, if he converts him, he gets him back into the truth. He helps him to see himself and he gets back into the truth. He had erred from the truth, but he gets back into the truth. Let's read. Let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the what? Now, notice here, the saint is called a what? A sinner. Well, let's back up to verse 19. What's the first word? Brother. Who's that talking to? That's the church, is that right? Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth and one do what? Convert him. Verse 20, let him know that he which converted the what? He's not talking about the sinner out in the street. He's talking about the sinner that is of the brethren. All right, you see that? Let him know that he which converted the sinner from the error of his way shall do what? Save a soul from death. And that death is eternal death that he will save him from. He's not talking about natural death. He's talking about eternal death. The soul that sinneth, it shall what? Die. He that converted the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a what? Hide a multitude of sins. Because he was converted and got himself straightened out, his sin is overlooked by God, which is his mercy, because he repented. This has to do with one that has gone off into false teaching. Because when one has gone off into false teaching, they have erred. They have gone off into error. And of course, it is very dangerous because through false teaching is the number one way to destroy masses of people. It's the number one way to destroy masses of people. So all of these things that we're dealing with today, that's why we need to cleave to the word of who? God. And get as much word and knowledge of God as we can, because everything that is being taught that is truth today is being challenged. Now, let's look at an example here. Let me see. Let's go to 1 Kings chapter 12. I'm going to get out a little early. Just a few of us. 1 Kings chapter 12. This is an example of corruption, an example of error. 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 25. All right. Now, Solomon has died, and his son Rehoboam took over. And God had told Solomon, he appeared to Solomon twice and told him, if you walk according to my laws, I'll establish your kingdom forever. But Solomon, the Bible says, loved many strange, what? Women. And the women turned his heart away from God. Solomon became so backslidden that he began to sacrifice his children to Moloch, throwing them in the fire. And the practice of the heathen of that time is sacrificing their children to gods. They would beat on these drums. And they would beat those drums so loud, and then they would take those children and throw them in the fire alive. And they would beat on those drums to try to drown out the screams of those children to the idol gods. Solomon was involved in that. So God appeared to him and told him, because you have basically backslid, I'm going to send judgment. But because of your father, I'm not going to do it in your lifetime. But when you die and your son take over, I'm going to split that kingdom. And so the time has now come. And of course, when Rehoboam took over, the people of God came to him and said, now your father was building the house of God and building his house for 20 years. He taxed us very hard. We think it's time for you to lighten the load a little bit, because everything is done. The house of God is done, and his house is done. And so he said, well, give me 3 days and I'll let you know. And so the Bible said he went and consulted the old men that were with Solomon. And they gave him the advice. But he ignored that. He listened to his buddies. Is that right? Those that were brought up with him. And he went back and said, my fingers shall be thicker than my father's loins. You think he's hard, I'm going to be even harder. And so what happened? 10 tribes revolted and went north and became known as the Northern Kingdom. And Rehoboam was left with 2 tribes in Jerusalem that became known as the Southern Kingdom. Because the Bible says this thing is from the Lord. So now we have Jeroboam. They made Jeroboam king over the 10 tribes, which became known as Israel. And the 2 tribes that remained in Jerusalem became known as Judah. All right? And so here we are, 1 Kings chapter 12, verse number 25. Let's read. Then Jeroboam built Shechem in Mount Ephraim and dwelt therein, and went out from thence and built Penuel. And Jeroboam said in his heart, now shall the kingdom return to the house of David. If this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me and go again. So in other words, he's going to lose all the members of his church. I'm going to lose all my members, and they're going to go right back where they came from. I'm just paraphrasing a little bit, but you get the point, don't you? I don't want to lose my members, so I got to do something to keep them. Let's read on. Whereupon the king took counsel and made 2 calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of what? Egypt. Because you see, Israel had to practice the feast of Jehovah. And they had to go up to Jerusalem because that's where the Ark of the Covenant was. So Jeroboam said, now I don't want to lose all these people. I like being king. I like having a big church. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to substitute for truth and set up these gods. Let's read verse 29. And he set the one in Bethel, and the other put he in what? Dan. And this thing became a sin, for the people went to worship before the one, even unto where? This became known throughout the Old Testament as Jeroboam's sin. It was one of the greatest sins that ever occurred in the Bible, because sin is either a greater sin or a lesser sin. And the degree of sin is determined by the amount of people that it affects. So he took 10 of God's 12 tribes off into idolatry. All because he wanted a big church. But you understand what we're saying, is that right? And don't you think that happens today?
Amen.
You don't think that don't happen today? Well, we're going to cancel Bible class for the whole summer. I know some pastors that cancel Bible class for the whole summer. That means that's just like you decide you ain't going to eat for the whole summer. How are you going to survive? Jesus said, give us this day our what? Daily bread. You know, but that's what they do. We had, Bishop Paddock told us about a female pastor, and this is not casting aspersion on female pastors, but she started a church in Jackson, Michigan. It was always hard to start a church in Jackson, Michigan, Bishop Paddock used to say. And we had a woman pastor before my time that started a church in Jackson. But every winter, she went down to Florida. So what happened to the church? So there could be no church. We had one pastor, Pastor Jones, who started to work, and he was trying to do the work of the Lord, but he had a wife that had a mental problem. And so she got so bad that she was put in a hospital, and they had to live separately because she was just out of control. And of course, one day she called him over and asked him if he could help her with something in the yard. And so he went out to the yard, and she went out after him, and then we turned around, she got a shotgun and shot and killed him. These are apostolic folk. So we had one pastor that was taking vacations on something in the wintertime, and the other pastor got killed. Now that's the church where I got saved in, eventually, years later. But it wasn't until Bishop Combs came to Jackson that finally there was a church established in Jackson. And it is the largest church in Jackson, Michigan to this day. But people do strange things in the pulpit to keep people in the seats. We say amen. And just like Jeroboam. And so they compromise. And so this was error. See, error is always usually associated with doctrine and teachings. And whenever a new king arose in Israel, the first thing the king did, the first thing that he did, if he was a wicked king, he would take down the priests of God. Because he realized that Israel, this nation, was a religious nation, and if I want to get them, I got to take the religion away from them and put up what I want. You ever notice that? When a good king came in, he put down the idolatrous priests. He did away with the high places, burning incense to those pagan gods, and he reestablished the order of God. Josiah did that. Who was Josiah's father? I think his name was Manasseh. Manasseh was the most wicked king that ever lived. He was more wicked than Ahab, because Manasseh communicated with familiar spirits. That's something Ahab never did. Ahab was just listening to his wife all the time, and that's how he was getting in trouble, because he was a wimp. Now, I'm not saying if you listen to the wife, you're a wimp, because I listen to mine. That's why I got this suit with this peach shirt. I never would have picked out a peach shirt. But she said, oh, I like that peach shirt. And I was giving out the money and getting it. So don't mistake that, because Jezebel was a wicked woman, you see. And Ahab should have been, he just was not a leader, you know. But Manasseh was the most wicked king, and Manasseh reigned for 55 years. And so when he died, his son Josiah took over. And he reestablished the order of God in the kingdom. And that's what the devil always does. When the devil attacks, he comes to attack what you believe about God. And we see that illustration through all of the kings that Israel had. I can't remember the number, how many of them they had, but that's what the enemy does. See, Satan is consistent with what he does. We know how he works, because he's consistent. And whenever he comes at us, it's to challenge what we know It's true. And what we cherish, that is true. Am I right or wrong? You know, do you really believe that? Do you really believe that God gonna make a way? He ain't made a way the last time. You don't even remember the last time. He just bring up the last time. Say whatever. You can do. So that's what he does. And so Jeroboam here, this became a great sin. Well, that's why he says this became a sin, for the people went to worship before the one, even unto Dan. Let's read verse 31. And he made an house of high places and made priests of the what? The lowest people, which were not of the sons of what? Levi. And Jeroboam ordained a feast in the eighth month on the 15th day of the month, like unto the feast that is in Judah. And he offered upon the altar, so did he in Bethel, sacrificed unto the calves that he had made. And he placed in Bethel the priests of the high places which he had made. Verse 33. So he offered upon the altar which he had made in Bethel, 15th day of the eighth month, even in the month which he had devised of his own heart, and ordained a feast unto the children of Israel. And he offered upon the altar and burnt what? Incense. He corrupted the people of God. Pastors can corrupt churches. Leaders can corrupt people. And this is what happens. So this example is given to us for us to realize that this is what happens today. This is why you see some of the things that go on in local churches, because they're trying not to get people saved. That's not their goal. Joel Osteen, and I'm not trying to speak disrespect Joel Osteen, he's the most televised preacher in the entire world. And the reason why he is because he doesn't want to step on anybody's toes. And he don't step on nobody's toes. Because he just gets up there and smiles. You know, he don't do no weddings. He don't do no funerals. He don't visit no sick. He don't do none of that. He gets up and speaks and gets in his car and go home. And gets paid millions of dollars. I'd be smiling too. But his father was an apostolic preacher. Too bad I don't know what happened to Joel. But his father was an apostolic preacher. I used to watch him. He was an apostolic preacher and preached with some power. You know, speaking in tongues and all that. Only tongue Joel is talking about is, how was your day today? Did the sun smile at you as you rose up? No, it didn't smile, because my shades was closed. I'm just trying to get you to see. That's all. I'm not trying to pick on these guys, but you know what I'm talking about. Is that right? I'm not jealous of him. I'm glad what I got. I ain't jealous of him. Because Bishop, I'm not going to say that. I was going to quote what Bishop Ellis said, but I don't want y'all to get misunderstand now, because I'm not trying to call anybody any devils. But we have some that act like devils. Is that right? But somebody asked Bishop Ellis a question. They said, what does it feel like to pastor 3,000 people? I'm talking about David Ellis. And he said, I don't know. And wait a minute, your church packed out? Everything. Said, yeah. He said, well, what is it like? He said, I don't know. He said, you think I pastor all these people? He said, I'm probably only pastoring 300 of these people. And that's a powerful statement. Because everybody in your church is not being pastored. Now, I would like to be the pastor of everybody at Greater Bethel, but that's not the case. Because there's some folk that he ain't my pastor. And that's all right, that's fine. You know, because I'm going to be in the rapture. How about you? I ain't worried about it. But I thought that was a very powerful statement for Bishop David Ellis to say that. I never thought anything like that. You automatically think that everybody is with you. Everybody not with you. Amen. Everybody in your circle of life ain't with you. You know that. everybody don't mean you good. If everybody didn't mean Jesus good and he was the epitome of good, then you know it ain't happening for us. Is that right? You get blessed, everybody ain't happy that you got blessed. I want to thank the Lord, I got a check in the mail. Somebody's like, I'm tired of her anyway. Oh, praise the Lord, honey, I enjoyed your testimony. All right, well, we almost finished. All right, well, let me see here. Let's go to, let me see. We're going to close out today. We're going to let you out early today. Are there any questions? Because I was going to get into presumptuous sins, but that's a little, we want to end on a high note. All right. Any questions tonight? Praise the Lord. No questions? All right. Well, we will prepare to take an offering and then be dismissed tonight. Let's continue. We have a lot of people to pray for. Praise the Lord. But we know God is able. Is that right? I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. It's encouraging.